pray together. Heavenly Father, we do thank you for the Bible study. We bless your name because you've gathered us here for a good purpose. And we pray that that purpose will be fulfilled in Jesus' name. Amen. We pray that you grant us a spirit of understanding. Amen. That you see Christ glorified, Christ exalted, Christ lifted up. And Lord, we'll see you in all your beauty and splendor. And you'll do great things in every life in Jesus' name. Bless your people tonight, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. God bless you. You can sit down. We're coming to Revelation chapter 1. For those who are joining us for the first time, I welcome you in Jesus' name. We're having some great, great time having the vision of the glorified Christ revealed unto us. And as you see Christ exalted tonight, Christ lifted up tonight, and Christ glorified tonight, I pray that glory will come into your life in Jesus' name. We're looking at Revelation chapter 1. If you remember what we've learned already, this is the revelation of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it was given by the Almighty God himself. And it was given to Christ and then passed through and signified or symbolized through an angel. And then it came to John. And John was so excited because he said, I'm the one receiving this. Look at chapter 1 verse 4. John to the seven churches which are in Asia. About seven churches there. Seven is the number of completeness and the number of perfection and the number of entirety, number of totality. It's actually sending this to all the churches. How do we know that? Because after each letter, after each epistle, after each episode to each of the churches, it said, he that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. But it was John that received this, and it came through John going to the churches, coming to our church, and coming unto you. And then I want you to look at verse 9. It says, I, John. He's been saying John, but now he says, I, John. It's no other than the apostle that Jesus loved. I, John, the apostle. It's no other than the one who had been converted at an early age. Church history tells us he was converted about the age of 25. And he says, I, John, and he's been following after the Lord until Jesus was crucified, until Jesus was buried, until Jesus rose again. And then when Jesus appeared to his disciples, he was there. And when Jesus was to be taken to heaven, he was there too. And Jesus went to heaven, and the angels appeared to them and told them, ye men of Galilee, why are you standing here gazing up into the sky, into heaven? This same Jesus will come again. It's coming again. And then at that time he'll receive us unto himself in Jesus' name. Now the Acts of the Apostles from chapter 1 to chapter 28 had been completed. And then you have many of the epistles written, almost everything written except this revelation. And now John was suffering persecution because he took his stand for the Lord. Like you'll take your stand for the Lord. You will not compromise. You will not backslide. You will not go back into sin. And because of that, at the time of the reign of Domitian, that was an emperor at that time, because he will not accept that Caesar is his Lord. He said, Jesus is Lord. And he preached the gospel, preached the word in its totality and entirety. Because of that, he was abandoned or banished to the Isle of Patmos, where he was suffering persecution. That's why he said, look at verse 9, I, John, who am also your brother and companion in tribulation. That's what tribulation there is, not the great tribulation. It's trouble, trial. It is persecution. And then he says, I'm your companion in the kingdom and in the patience, perseverance of Jesus Christ. And then he tells us, I was in the isle that is called Patmos. At that time, when you took those people, they counted as criminals, because Christians were counted as criminals, because they were not going to bow down to any image, and were not going to worship Caesar. They said they were criminals to the kingdom or to the empire of Rome. And so he was banished there. They'll lash them, they will beat them, they will scorch them, and then they'll put them to hard labor. At this time, we're told that John was about 96 years of age. That means he'd been following the Lord for more than 70 years. And now, old man, old believer, old disciple, old apostle, he was banished there. Then he said in verse 10, I was in the spirit on the Lord's day, that was on Sunday, the first day of the week, and I heard behind me a great voice as of a trumpet saying, I am Alpha and Omega. John, you are right calling me Lord. I am Alpha and Omega. John, it's all right. You stood for me and you said that Caesar is not Lord, and that the kingdoms of this world, they'll become my kingdom eventually. You are right. I am Alpha and Omega. I'm the first, I'm the last. When all the people that are persecuting you, when they have all passed away, I will still be there. I was before them the first, and I will be after them, I'll be the last. And then he says, what thou seest, write in a book, and said unto the seven churches which are in Asia. And then he tells us, unto Ephesus, and unto Smyrna, and unto Pergamos, and unto Thyatira, and unto Sardis, and unto Philadelphia, and unto Laodicea. At this time, John had not seen anyone. He was just hearing a voice, and the voice was like that of a trumpet. It was a mighty voice. And then he said, who is this talking to me? Look at verse 12. And I turned to see the voice that spake with me. And being turned, I saw seven golden candlesticks. He'll tell us the meaning of that later. And in the midst of the seven candlesticks, one like unto the Son of Man. He said, now I recognize him. He's the Son of Man. That's my Savior. That's my Lord. Only that now is glorified. Only that now is exalted. Only that now is not like it was when he was on earth. It said, like the Son of Man, clothed with a garment down to the feet, and girt about with paths with a golden girdle. It said, and his ears were white like wool, as white as snow, and his eyes were as a flame of fire. John is saying, look at this. This is glorified Christ. And look at him. This is the exalted one. You know, when he was here on earth, John would lean upon his chest and would lean upon his bosom. But now he saw something different, and he said in verse 15, at his feet like as unto fine brass, as if it were burnt in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. And he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword, and his countenance was as the sun shined in his strength. He said, I look at his countenance. I can remember now. There was a time he took us to the Mount of Transfiguration, and then his glory shone forth temporarily at that time. But even at that time, it was not like this. When you look at him from the top to the bottom, you look at him and you gaze at him, you're seeing something here. And he says that as I look at his face, his countenance, it was like a sun in shining in its strength. Look at verse 17. And when I saw him, I did what? I fell at his feet as dead. When I saw him like that, when I saw his glory, this is my Lord. This is Jesus Christ. This is my Redeemer. It was something much more than he could take. And he laid his right hand upon me, saying unto me, fear not. I am the first, I am the last. I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I'm alive forevermore. And everybody said, yeah. Amen. And I have the keys of hell and death. He says, I'm the final authority. Don't mind Domitians, and don't mind Pharaoh, don't mind all those people that are trying to tell you that they're the final power. And they think that your life depends on them. They think that how long you are going to live or when you are going to die depends on them. Not at all. I am the Alpha, I am the Omega, I am the first, I am the last, and I have the keys of death and hell. And then it says in verse 19, write the things which thou hast seen, the glory of Christ that you have seen, write it down. And the exaltation of Christ that you have seen, write it down. So that the people that only knew about the humiliation of Jesus Christ when he was here on earth, they will read this and know that things are different now. It's no more in humiliation, it's now in exaltation. Write the things which thou hast seen, past tense, and the things which are present tense, that you find in chapters 2 and 3 concerning the churches. And then it says, and the things which shall be hereafter. That's from chapter 4 to the end. That means the book is divided into three parts. The past, what you've seen, that's chapter 1. And then what the things which are, that's chapter 2, chapter 3. And then the things which shall be hereafter, chapter 4, all through to verse 20, chapter 22. And the mystery of the seven stars, which thou sawest in my right hand, and the seven golden candlesticks. Write all that down. And the seven stars are the angels and the leaders, the ministers of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. That's what we're looking at tonight. We're talking tonight and teaching tonight on the mighty glorified Christ. It's about Christ, the Son of God. About Christ, the Son of Man. But it's the glorified Christ, the mighty glorified Christ. Here is the revelation of Christ in his glory. Revelation of Christ in his authority. Revelation of Christ in his exaltation and his majesty. He, John, saw and heard much more than what he saw on the Mount of Transfiguration. The vision of the glorified Son of Man had a great effect and impact on him. That he said, I fell down as if I was dead. And then Christ spoke reassuring words and said, fear not. And then gave a strengthening touch and touched him, lifted him up and strengthened him and said, rise up. You have some duty to perform, you're right, and then you send this to the people that will benefit, and that's how it came to you. It has been sent to us now, and you're going to benefit from this. You see Christ in his glorified form. You see Christ in his glorious form. It will turn your life around in Jesus' name. You know that Jesus has all power. He has all authority, and that power will operate in your life. And whatever has made you afraid, whatever has bent you down, and whatever had bent you low, tonight, as you see Christ as he really is now in glory, all your fears will vanish away. And every power of the enemy, every power of any emperor in your life, emperor visible, emperor invisible, tonight, they are crushed in Jesus' name. What did I say the topic of tonight is? Wonderful church, wonderful church. The mighty glorified Christ. There are 3 points we're talking about. Number one, the majesty of the glorified Christ. The majesty of the glorified Christ. Number two is the mystery. The mystery. You find that word mystery in the last verse, verse 20 there. The mystery. We're talking about the mystery of the glorious Christ. The mystery of the glorious Christ. Number three, point number three, the mandate. Mandate, that's a commandment. The mandate, that's a commission. The mandate, that's an imperative. What he said now, John, get up, and this is what to do. The mandate from the governing Christ. He is the governor. He is the leader. He is the ruler. He is the captain. He is the one that is going to rule from shore to shore. And he is the governing Christ. The mandate from the governing Christ. Number one. Tell me number one there. The majesty of the glorified Christ. Remember now, this is the revelation and the vision. and the pinching of the Lord Jesus Christ. And he's talking about who Jesus is now. And there's no other glorious or glorified personality. And you should be glad if you're a believer, you're a child of God, and then Christ appears. He says, you say you're born again, you say you're redeemed, you say you're a child of God, and you say that you're following Jesus Christ. Do you know how Jesus is? Do you know what Jesus is? Do you know what he looks like now? Do you know his power? Do you know his majesty? Do you know his authority? And then he draws the curtain. He says, see your Lord. And when you see your Lord, every fear will vanish from your heart. Look at verse 12. Look at chapter 1, verse 12. And I turn to see. And I turn to see. I will see. I said, I will see. You know, some people, they see more of the devil. John said, I see Christ. Other people, they see more of darkness. And he said, I see the light. This is the light of the world. Other people, they see problem. He says, I see power. I see Jesus Christ. He said, I turned to see the voice that spake with me. And being turned, I saw. Being turned, I saw. I turned around, had an intention to see. I said, Lord, show me. I'm going to see something. Who wants to see something today? You will see. You will see somebody. And that somebody will drive all your fears away. That somebody will solve all your problems. That somebody will knock the devil on the head and he'll say, I have the key of your destiny. And the power that sets you free is here tonight. Thank God you are here tonight. This Christ we are talking about, he will reveal himself to you. You will never be the same again. Look at this. And then it says, in the midst of the candlestick, one like unto the Son of Man. Stop right there. It said, this one in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks is like the Son of Man. Many people do not understand, that term. And you see that Jesus Christ used the term many, many times when he was here on earth. He said, I am the Son of Man. And people think, okay, Son of Man is like one of us. Son of Man is as weak as we are. We are tired, he is tired. And we are hungry, he is hungry. And we are thirsty, he is thirsty. Because he put on humanity. It's like a servant. Look at that term, Son of Man. Daniel chapter 7. In Daniel chapter 7, I'm looking at verse 9. Daniel chapter 7, you have to open your Bible, because when you see it yourself, it will bring power in your life. Daniel chapter 7, verse 9. I beheld till the thrones were cast down. All thrones contrary to your life, contrary to the Christian faith, will be cast down in Jesus' name. I beheld till the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days did see it, whose garment was white as snow, and the hair of his head like pure wool, and his throne was like the fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire. Look at verse 13. And I saw, this Daniel, and I saw, Daniel saw, John saw, it's my turn to see. I saw in the night vision, behold, one like, tell me out loud, like the Son of Man came with the clouds of heaven, and came to the Ancient of Days, and they brought him, the Son of Man, near unto him, the Ancient of Days, and there was given dominion and glory and a kingdom, that all people and nations and languages should serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which shall not pass away, and his kingdom that which shall not be destroyed. That's the Son of Man. It's not the weak, the hungry person, a human being like just you and I. This one is the King of glory. This is a King of power. This is a King with all majesty. And he's coming. And Jesus knew he was. Just knew he was. Look at Matthew chapter 26. Matthew chapter 26. Son of Man. I saw the Son of Man. And he saw his glory. He saw his majesty. We're looking at Matthew chapter 26. And we're looking at verse 63. And Jesus held his peace, and the high priest answered and said unto him, I adjure thee by the living God that thou tell us whether thou be the Christ, the Son of God. The high priest wanted to know, because accusations came this way and that way. Are you the one? Are you the Son of God? Look at the answer. And Jesus says unto him, thou hast said, nevertheless, I say unto you, hereafter ye shall see, tell me, Son of Man. See that. Are you the Son of God? That's the question. And then he said, thou hast said, but hereafter thou shalt see the Son of Man. Why did he use the term Son of Man? Because he wanted the high priest to know that I am that Son of Man that came to the Ancient of Days that Daniel spoke about. And the high priest understood that. That's why, look at this. Hereafter shall ye see the Son of Man sitting on the right hand of power and coming in the clouds of heaven. Then the high priest rent his clothes, saying, he has spoken blasphemy. That's what he understood. He understood that Jesus was saying, I'm the Son of Man you read about in Daniel. I'm the Son of Man that is coming with the clouds, and I'm going to reign upon this earth. And the high priest did not believe that. That's why he said, he has spoken blasphemy. What further witness, what further need have we of witnesses? Behold, now ye have heard his blasphemy. But thank God, I believe in the Son of Man. It's coming in glory. It's coming in power. It's coming in majesty. And I pray you'll be ready on that day in Jesus' name. Come back now. We're looking at Revelation chapter 1. And we're looking at verse 13. It says in verse 13, the Son of Man clothed with a garment down to the foot. Clothed with a garment down to the foot. It's describing what he saw. And he's saying that this one I saw, the clothing is not like the clothing was wearing when he was here on earth. That those soldiers took, and then they wanted to patch. They divided this among themselves, and the other seamless one, they just, they gambled on it and tossed, head or tail or whatever, and then gave it to somebody. He said, this one is made from heaven. This one is the garment of the prophet, the garment of the prince, and the garment of the priest. It's talking about the identity of Jesus Christ, and it's talking about the office of Jesus Christ. And he said, look at his clothing. We're coming back to Daniel. And this is Daniel chapter 10. Daniel chapter 10. And Daniel is describing this similar thing that he saw, because Daniel saw the visions of the end of time, just like John saw the vision of the end of time. We're looking at Daniel chapter 10, verse 5. Then I lifted up mine eyes and looked, and behold, a certain man clothed in linen, whose loins were girded with a fine gold of Ophir, and his body also was like beryl, and his face as the appearance of lightning, and his eyes as lamps of fire, and his arms and his feet like in color to polished brass, and his voice like the voice of a multitude. And I, Daniel, alone saw the vision, for the men that were with me saw not the vision, but a great earthquake fell upon them, so that they fled to hide themselves. Look at that. This was Jesus before his incarnation. This was Jesus before he came to the world. And then he came to the world and just saw him. And now we see Revelation chapter 1, and that's Jesus after his death, after his resurrection, after his ascension, the glorified Christ. Daniel saw him before he came to this world. And then John saw him when he was in the world. And now he saw him after he left this world. It was a revelation of glory. I pray that you see his glory. I said you see his glory. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 11. We're still looking at this, and we're following through on the clothes that he wore. Isaiah chapter 11, verse 4. But with righteousness shall he judge the poor. That's why I told you, it's a picture of Jesus Christ as a prince. as the King of Kings, as the Lord of authority, as the God of authority, and as the one that has all power in his hand. And with righteousness shall he judge the poor, and reprove with equity for the meek of the earth. And he shall smite the earth with the rod of his mouth, and with the breath of his lips shall he slay the wicked. Look at this. And righteousness shall be the girdle of his loins. The clothing that you saw, that's a picture of his righteousness. The garment of righteousness, pure righteousness, without any stain of sin. And then he goes on to say, and faithfulness, the girdle of his race. So coming back to Revelation chapter 1, we're looking at the majesty of the glorified Christ. And now we come to verse 14. Look at verse 14, chapter 1. His head and his ears were, tell me, white like wool, and as white as snow. He's talking about his head and his ears. He's talking about, actually, you need to understand something. This, verse 14, I know you know the answer, but I'm going to ask you, who is this talking about? I said, who is this talking about? Jesus Christ. Listen to this now, and look at this. It says his head, the head of Jesus, and his ears, the ears of Jesus, they were, tell me, white like wool, and white as, tell me. Okay, put your hand there and come to Daniel. As you come to Daniel, want to make some comparison now. We're looking at Daniel chapter 7. Daniel chapter 7, and I'm reading here from verse 9. Are you there? Daniel chapter 7, verse 9. I beheld the thrones were cast down, and the Ancient of Days. Ancient of Days, who is that? God Almighty, that's God the Father. And the Ancient of Days did sit, whose garment was white as snow, and his ear, the ear of his head, tell me, like pure wool. His throne was like a fiery flame, and his wheels as burning fire. What are we talking about? Daniel says, when I saw the Ancient of Days, the Almighty God, look at his ear, look at his head, as white as snow. John says, when I saw Jesus Christ, the Son of Man, look at his head, look at his hair, white as snow. He's telling us, I and my Father are one. That is, the Heavenly Father, the Ancient of Days, look at him, and then turn around and look at Jesus, exactly the same. I and my Father are one. There's no difference. That's why when Thomas eventually, when he got the truth, he bent low, he worshipped, and he fell down and said, my Lord and my God. He is God. And then we're coming back now to Revelation. Revelation chapter 1, I'm reading the latter part of verse 14. In verse 14, his eyes were as a flame of fire. His eyes like a flame of fire. What does that mean? Look at this. We're looking at chapter 2 of Revelation. I'm reading from verse 18. And unto the angel of the church in Tartan write, this thing says the Son of Man, the Son of God, who has his eyes like unto a flame of fire, and his feet like fine brass. I know thy works, and thy charity, and thy service, and thy faith, and thy patience, and thy works, and the last of them more than the first. Nevertheless, notwithstanding, I have somewhat against thee. When he talks about the eyes like glitter, eyes that can see through, eyes that can see the public and the private, that can see the secret and the thing that is open, that can see everything. That's why we're told in Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4, about the eyes of the Lord, about the knowledge of the Lord, about the penetrating knowledge of the Lord, a God of heaven. It tells us in Hebrews chapter 4 and in verse 13, neither is there any creature that is not manifest in his sight, but all things are naked and open unto the eyes of him with whom we have to do. That means he sees everything. He sees the secret. He sees everything that is even in the open. What an encouragement for the believer. Your enemies cannot hide anywhere that God will not see them. I said, your enemies cannot hide anywhere. They cannot take your name somewhere and take your whatever it is somewhere and say, nobody will know this one. We're going to do concoction. We're going to do this and that. And we're going to hurt him. Jesus, your Lord and Savior, can see through everything. And before they finish, he'll scatter everything. And then there's nobody that can hide in a dark place and commit sin and say, God will never know this one. Christ will never see this one. We're dealing with him who can see everything. He knows everything. That's the reason why you know you're a sinner. You've done something bad. And then you think, I don't know. She doesn't know. He doesn't know. There is a God who knows. There's a Christ who knows. You'll go to Christ and say, Lord, I know you see everything. You know everything. Wash me. I shall be whiter than snow. He'll wash you in Jesus' name. And then we're told in Revelation chapter 1 verse 15, and his feet was like fine brass, as if they burnt in a furnace, and his voice as the sound of many waters. He talks about his voice, and then he talks about his feet. He's talking about judgment there. He's talking about what the people of the world will go through when Jesus comes, because he's going to thresh them. Is going to pounce them with those feet like brass. Isaiah chapter 63. Isaiah chapter 63. I'm reading from verse 1. Who is this that cometh from Edom with dyed garments of Bozrah? This that is glorious in his apparel. Glorious in his apparel. Who are we talking about? I said, who are we talking about? Tell me out loud. This is the glorified Christ. He that is glorious in his apparel, traveling in the greatness of his strength. I that speak in righteousness, mighty to save. Who is that? Jesus our Savior. Wherefore art thou red in thine apparel, and thy garments like him that treadeth in the winepress. I have trodden the winepress alone, and of the people there was none with me, for I will tread them in mine anger. So you understand, when he's talking about his feet, the feet of brass that is like his bones in a furnace, he's talking about judgment. And he says, and trampled them in my fury, and their blood shall be sprinkled upon my garment, and I will stain all my raiment. Look at this. For the day of vengeance is in mine heart, and the year of my redeemed is come. So you understand, when he talks about Revelation chapter 1 verse 15, and he talks about his feet like that of brass burnt in a furnace, he's talking about the day of judgment, when it was threshed, and when he will punish, and when he will press, when he will punish all those sinners. In verse 15, the latter part, and his voice as the voice of many waters. His voice like the voice of many waters. He's talking about the voice that will shake everything shakeable. And when people hear that, in that coming day, they will run for shelter. There will be nowhere for them to hide. We're looking at Hebrews chapter 12. Hebrews chapter 12, and I'm reading from verse 19. Look at verse 19. It says, and the sound of a trumpet, and the voice of words, which voice they that heard entreated that the word should not be spoken to them anymore. It will drive fear into the heart of the unbelievers when they hear that voice, because it's called them, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Those who accept, wonderful, your name will be in the book of life. And then when Christ comes, you'll come with him, because he's coming with 10,000s of his saints. And then you rejoice, because already you're an overcomer. But those who reject that invitation, when he says, come unto me, I will give you eternal life, I'll give you rest. Those who reject, they'll hear that voice on the final day. It will drive fear into their heart. Look at verse 25. See that ye refuse him not that speaketh. For if they escape not, who refused him that spake on earth? How much more shall not we escape if we turn away from him that speaketh from from heaven, whose voice, that's it, whose voice then shook the earth. But now he has promised, saying, yet once more, I will not shake the earth only, but also the heavens. And this word, yet more, yet once more, signifies the removing of those things that are shaken, as of the things that are made, that those things which cannot be shaken may remain. And then it says, wherefore, we're receiving a kingdom. I pray you'll be there. Amen. We're receiving a kingdom. I said you'll be there. Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. But when you are born again, thank God, you'll be part of the people receiving the kingdom. We receive in a kingdom which cannot be moved. Let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. Tell me verse 29. 1, 2, 3, go properly. Say it convincingly. But God is a consuming fire. It tells us, as we look at John, it tells us the glorified Christ will bring peace to the believer, will bring joy to the believer, will bring assurance to the believer, and will bring confidence to the believer. Say, that's my Savior. That's my Lord. See how great he is, and see how exalted he is, and see how powerful and mighty he is, and he is my Savior. As the appearance of the glorified Christ bring peace and assurance and confidence to the believers, it will bring fear and trembling to the unbelievers, because it will mean, that's the person I rejected. I rejected him as Savior. Now he's going to be my judge. And where will they hide on that day? I pray you'll come to the right side. You'll be a child of God. Your sins washed away. And then you will know, he is my Savior. Somebody tell me, he is my Savior. I want to hear you well.
He is my Savior.
The Lord confirm it in Jesus' name. We come to point number 2 of the mystery of the glorious Christ. The mystery of the glorious Christ. We're looking at Revelation chapter 1. Revelation chapter 1, and I'm reading here from verse 16. In verse 16, look at it. And he had in his right hand 7 stars. And out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword. And his countenance was as the sun that shineth in his strength. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. And he laid his right hand upon me, saying unto me, fear not, I am the first and the last. I am he that liveth and was dead. And behold, I am alive forevermore. Amen. And have the keys of hell and death. As you look at this, there are a few things here. Look at that verse 16. It says, and he had in his right hand 7 stars. What's that? Look at verse 20 and see the interpretation of those 7 stars. The mystery of the 7 stars which thou sawest in my right hand, and the 7 golden candlesticks. The 7 stars are the angels of the 7 churches. The 7 stars are the ministers of the 7 churches. The 7 stars are the messengers. Angels, minister, messenger, the same thing. They are the messengers of the 7 churches. And the 7 golden candlesticks with thou sawest are the 7 churches. What do we learn from that? That Jesus said, I hold those stars. I hold those ministers, those messengers. That means if you're a leader, that means if you're a worker, that means you're a servant of the Lord is holding your hand. And the Lord is keeping you. And the Lord is protecting you, because you are in his hand. You are not in Satan's hand. You are nearer Christ than Satan. You are nearer protection than insecurity. Your life is protected by the Lord, because he says, those stars, they are in his hand. He will hold you. And he will keep you. And if you're a Christian, you're a believer, he's holding your hand. He will empower you. He will strengthen you. And you will not be lost in Jesus' name. But look at this, look at this. I'm looking at it now. I'm looking at chapter 1, chapter 2, verse 1. Look at chapter 2, verse 1. It says, unto the angel of the church in Ephesus write, these things says he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, and walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. Do you know that all these churches, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, Ephesus, Smyrna, Pergamos, and Thyatira, and Sardis, and Philadelphia, and Laodicea, they were different, and yet Jesus said, I'm holding them. You see, there are many people, they don't understand. There are two sides to the promise of God. There are two sides to the protection of God. There are two sides to the effectiveness of the people of God. On the one side, we see his sovereignty. On the other hand, we see our responsibility. That's why you find the differences. The same Christ, the same power, the same grace, the same opportunity, the same promises, everything in the Bible available for you, available for me. And it says everything can be yours. And yet, because on the one hand, his sovereignty, which is constant for everybody, now our responsibility. I pray that you rise up to your responsibility. Number one, his faithfulness. Number two, our freedom. You see, his faithfulness is a faithful God. Faithful to you and faithful to me. Faithful to the men and faithful to the women. He's faithful to the ministers, faithful to the members. Why are we then different? Because we're free moral agents. Free moral agents. So that the freedom we have, we may use the freedom positively and say, praise the Lord, I'm going to take all the promises of God. That's the reason why the differences are there. Number three is power and our perseverance in his keeping. He has the power to keep. That's why he's holding the seven stars in his hand. He has the power to keep. Why is it then that some people were lukewarm, and some people are fervent, and some people have lost their first love, and some people are still keeping their first love? Some people are well consecrated, and some people are like they're not well consecrated. You know why? Number one, his faithfulness on the one hand is faithful to everyone, but then our own freedom and the power to keep in his hand, and our perseverance in his keeping. And then number four is promised security. His promised security. He promises us, I will keep you. I'll keep you. When you go through the fire, I'll be with you. I said, when you go through the fire, he'll be with you. And then when you go through the waters, you'll not be drowned. That's the promise for everyone. We have the promised security, but then the conditional security. If you hear my word and you continue in my word, then ye my disciples indeed. That's the reason you have those differences. We're coming back to chapter 1, verse 16. Look at verse 16 there. It says, and he had in his right hand seven stars, and out of his mouth went a sharp two-edged sword. Out of his mouth went a two-edged sword. What's that for? What's that for? It is for the judgment of the people that do not live the way they ought to live. Come to Revelation chapter 2 verse 12. Revelation chapter 2 verse 12. And to the angel of the church in Pergamos write, this thing says he which has, look at this, the sharp sword with two edges. That's Christ. And then he has the sharp sword coming out. He says, I know thy works, in verse 13, and where thou dwellest, verse 13, and even where Satan's seat is, and thou holdest fast my name, and hast not denied my faith, even in those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you where Satan dwelleth. Verse 14, but I pray that every but God will rectify your life. Yeah. You know, the Lord saying, this is good, that is good, but I love you, I appreciate you, but I know you are born again, but I know you are dedicated and devoted, even your first words greater than the last words, but today the Lord will rectify that but. Yeah. It says, but I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, who taught Balak to cast a stumbling block before the children of Israel and to eat things sacrificed to idols and to commit fornication. It says, you're good, you're nice, you're following me, you're enduring, you're persevering, but you have compromisers with you there in that local church, and you are not checking up on them, and you are not restraining them, and you are not putting them where they ought to be. It says in verse 15, so as thou also, them that have that hold the doctrine of Nicolaitans, which thing I hate. There are people in your local church, Christ was telling this church, that are preaching false doctrine, erroneous doctrine, the things that I hate, and you are not checking them. Look at verse 16 now. Repent, or else I will come unto thee quickly and will fight them against them. Tell me the rest. With the sword of my mouth. That's why he has that sword. You know, he is his king, his prince, his lord, is the lion of the tribe of Judah, is the judge of all the earth, and is the judge in his church. Is redeemer, yes. Is a savior, yes. Is lord, yes. Is also the judge. And I pray that you'll not see the wrong side of the sword in your life, in Jesus' name. Now we're looking, come back to chapter 1, and we're looking at verse 16. Chapter 1, verse 16, the latter part, and his countenance was as the sun shineth in his strength. It's like you are out in the afternoon, and then you look at the sun at 12 noon, and the thing is shining, and then it says all the clouds are cleared off, and everything, the strength of the sun is coming on very, very bright, as the sun shineth in his strength. When that kind of a thing happens, look at the effect. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles, chapter 26, and we're reading from verse 13. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 26, we're looking at verse 13. The sun shining in strength, the countenance, the face, the appearance of the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at this. You know, Acts chapter 26 is talking about the experience of Saul and how Christ had gone to heaven. And Saul was going on his journey to Damascus. He wanted to go and arrest the children of God. And those who are coming to arrest you, to trouble you, before they get to you, the Lord will arrest them. And the Lord will stop them right there, because you are precious in the sight of the Lord. Look at what happened to him. It said in Acts of the Apostles, chapter 26, verse 13, at midday, O king, I saw in the way a light from heaven above the brightness of the sun shining round about me and them that journeyed with me. And when we were all falling to the earth, they will fall to the ground. When that light comes, the bright shining light that is the countenance of Jesus Christ, more than the brightness of the sun, it says, I had the voice speaking unto me, saying in Hebrew tongue, Saul, Saul, why persecutest thou me? Anybody persecuting you is persecuting Jesus. And Jesus can handle that. I said, Jesus will handle that. Thank God you are secure in God's hand. Am I talking to somebody there today? You are secured in Jesus' name. And he said, it is hard for thee to kick against the priest. And I said, who art thou, Lord? And he said, I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. That man was transformed and changed. Those enemies following after you, they will change. I said, they will change. We're coming back to Revelation chapter 1, and I'm reading from verse 17. And when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. He wasn't expecting this. Remember, John was in the Isle of Patmos. And then on the Lord's day, he was meditating on, if he had been in town, he would have gone to church, he would have gone to worship the Lord. But he was yet suffering persecution. And he said, on the Lord's day, I was in the spirit. All of a sudden, he heard a voice. And then he turned to see the voice that spoke to him. And now he saw the picture, he saw the portrait of this glorified and glorious Christ. And when he saw that, his frame, his constitution, his earthly makeup could not bear that. And that's why it says, and when I saw him, I fell at his feet as dead. And he laid his right hand upon me. That right hand is mighty. That right hand is glorious. That right hand is powerful. And when that hand touches you, something will change. Your weakness will turn to strength. Your sorrow will turn to joy. And all the panicking and, you know, fearing as if this is going to happen, there will be peace and rest in your soul in Jesus' name. Even that peace is there already. I said the joy is there already. And the confidence is there already. He laid his hands upon me saying, fear not, I am the first and the last. Your enemies are not as strong as I am, fear not. Your difficulties are not so great, I cannot handle, fear not. And all the powers of the enemy, that they are rushing like a mighty wind, before they get to you there, they will have to stop. That's why it says, fear not, because I am the first and I am the last. And then he goes on to tell us in verse 18, I am he that liveth and was dead, and behold, I am alive forevermore. And somebody said, amen. Amen. And I have the keys of hell and death. He has the key. I said he has the key. What can he do with that key? Look at this. We're looking at Revelation chapter 20, the key. The key in the hands of Jesus. We're looking at Revelation chapter 20, verse 1. And I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit, and a great chain in his hand. And he laid hold on the dragon, that old serpent, which is the devil and Satan, and tell me, bound him up. That's the key. That's the authority. That's the power. He can bind your enemy. He can bind the devil. And then he can say no to death that is rushing after you. You say, you know, in our family, this one is gone, that one is gone, that one is gone. And I had a dream that now it's my turn. No, it's not your turn. Because you're serving Jesus who has the key of death and the key of hell. And because of that, when he opens, nobody can shut. And when he shuts, nobody can open. We're looking at Revelation chapter 3, verse 7. Revelation chapter 3, verse 7. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these things says he that is holy, he that is true. And then he goes on and says, he that has the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth. He that openeth and no man shutteth. He that shutteth and no man openeth. You know, sometimes there are some people, they forget themselves. They say, we're powerful. And if you don't, put us in the equation of your life, we'll spoil all your plan, we'll destroy you. And then you are afraid. From tonight, all fear is gone from your life. When he opens a door of opportunity for you, he does not give the key of your destiny to the hands of your enemies. He has not given the key of your destiny to the hands of the devil. He holds that key. The key of your life. The key of your destiny. And the key of your success. And the key of your breakthrough. When he opens, no man, demonic man, no man, occultic man, no man, idolatrous man, can shut this door that is open before you in Jesus' name. And then when sickness is coming, infirmity coming, curse coming, you coming, and he sees it's coming your direction, he locks that door. And then he holds the key in his pocket. And nobody can take that key and open that thing. Because calamity will not get to you. Those evil things will not get to you. He opens the door, nobody can shut. He closes the door and nobody can open. Child of God, there, now you can rest. Now you can have confidence. The key is in the hand of your Savior. The key is in the hand of your Lord. I'm looking at somebody, you will succeed. I'm looking at somebody that you'll get well. I said you'll get well. All the powers of the enemies, they are destroyed in Jesus' name. Look at verse 8. Look at verse 8. I know thy works. Behold, I have set, and I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my words, and hast not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them come and worship before thy feet. To know that I have loved thee. He loves me. I said he loves me. I said he loves me. No darkness will overcome my life. No enemy will overcome my life. My Savior is the glorified Christ, the exalted Christ, the one that has all power, and no power will ever defeat you in Jesus' name. We come to point number three now, the mandate from the governing Christ. The mandate from the governing Christ. First of all, let me clear this up. We talk about Christ, and we say he's the governing Christ. That means the governor. We're coming to Psalm 22. Come to Psalm 22. In Psalm 22, first of all, I'll start from verse 1. I'm going to select some verses for you to know that this is talking about Jesus Christ. Are you there? Psalm 22. Have you opened your Bible? My God, why hast thou forsaken me? Who said that? That's Jesus. I'm coming to verse 7. All they that see me laugh me to scorn. They shoot out the limb and they shake the head, saying, he trusted on the Lord that he would deliver him. Let him deliver him, seeing he delighted in him. That's what they said when they were casting aspersions to Jesus Christ. Look at verse 16. Verse 16. For dogs have compassed me, and the assembly of the wicked have been close me. Tell me the rest there. Who is that? They pierced my hand and my feet. But thank God he did not remain on the cross. Thank God he did not remain in the grave. Thank God he rose on the third day, and he rose triumphant, and he rose an overcomer, and he rose a conqueror. And when he rose as a conqueror, now look at verse 28. For the kingdom is the Lord's, and he is, tell me, the governor among the nations. The governor among the nations. He will reign. He will rule. And the government of your life will be upon his shoulder in Jesus' name. Isaiah chapter 9. I'm reading here from verse 6. For unto us a child is born, unto us his son is given, and the government shall be upon his shoulder, and his name shall be called, tell me, Wonderful, tell me, Counselor, tell me, the Mighty God, the Everlasting Father, the Prince of Peace. Look at this. Of the increase of his government and peace there shall be no end. You see that? He's the governor. And because he's the governor, he's the governing Christ. And now we're looking at the mandate. Come back to Revelation chapter 1. Revelation chapter 1. I'm reading from verse 19. Revelation chapter 1 verse 19. Write the things which thou hast seen. What are the things which thou hast seen? It's talking about what John had just seen now. It's talking about chapter 1 of Revelation. It's talking about the picture and then the glory and the vision of the glorified Christ, chapter 1. And then the next part, and the things which are, Which are the things that are? The things that are happening in Ephesus, and also in Smyrna, and also in Pergamos, and then in Thyatira, and then in Sardis, and then in Philadelphia, and then in Laodicea. That's chapter 2 and chapter 3. The things that are. Look at the latter part there, and then in verse 19, and the things which shall be hereafter. If you look at chapter 4, it says in chapter 4, verse 1, after this I looked, that's after the present age, that's after the church age, after this I looked, and behold, the door was open in heaven, and the first voice which I heard, as it were, a trumpet talking with me, which said, come hither, and I will show you the things which must be hereafter. Not happened yet, hereafter. He's talking about the future. And so you have the three parts there, the things that you have seen, past, the things that are present, and the things that shall be hereafter, that is future. And the Lord was telling John to write. And then he said in verse 20, the mystery, write about that, of the seven stars, which thou sawest in my hand, and the seven golden candlesticks. And then he gives us the interpretation and the implication of this. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven candlesticks which thou sawest are the seven churches. Let's look at the mandate now. What was John to do? And you are learning from this, if you're like John, because John says, I'm a companion in persecution, a companion in the patience of Jesus Christ, a companion in the kingdom of Jesus Christ. If you're born again, that's it. And if you are perseveringly following after the Lord, that's it. And if you have suffered persecution for righteousness' sake, that's it. You're like John, even though your persecution might be different. Now he gives us the mandate. What's the mandate? Number one, write and send. Write and send. We're looking at chapter 1, verse 11. Chapter 1, verse 11, Revelation. Saying, I am Alpha and Omega, the first and the last. And what thou seest, write in a book and send it unto the seven churches which are in Asia. The first thing is write and send. You can do that too. The message of the gospel, the picture, the portrait of Jesus Christ, the glory of Jesus Christ, the office of Jesus Christ, the ministry of Jesus Christ. You can write, you can put in a text and send. You can write it on email and send. You can write it like a letter and send. You can write your testimony about how Christ is your Savior, your Redeemer, how the Lord has turned your life around for the better, and send. You can write the prophecies. You can write, you can quote them. You can write the promises of the Lord. Write and send. That's the mandate. Not only that, number two, write and call to first love. Look at chapter 2. Chapter 2, I'm reading from verse 1. Unto the angel of the church of Ephesus, write. That's the mandate. That's the commandment. Write. This thing says he that holdeth the seven stars in his right hand, and who walketh in the midst of the seven golden candlesticks. Look at verse 4. Nevertheless, I have somewhat against thee, because thou hast left thy first love. Remember therefore from whence thou art fallen, and repent and do the first works. What was John doing here? Write and call them back to their first love. You know some believers who are getting cold. You know some believers who are losing their consecration. You know some believers who are no more loving God with all their heart, all their soul, all their mind. The mandate is write and call them back to their first love. Your friend, write to him, write to her. Send a text to her or speak to her. Write and call them back to the first love. Number three, write and inspire faithfulness. Write and inspire faithfulness. We're looking at Revelation chapter 2, and I'm reading here from verse 8. Look at verse 8. Unto the church of the church, unto the angel of the church in Smyrna, write. That's a command. That's a command. Write. This thing says the first and the last, which was dead and is alive. And then he goes to look at verse 10. Fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Inspire courage. Inspire confidence. Inspire kind of fortitude in the lives of the people. As you write, are you writing a tract? Are you writing a book? Are you writing a text? Are you writing something in a magazine? You're writing to people, write and send. There's no point just writing it and then keeping it there. Just writing it and printing it and keeping it there in the warehouse. You write and you send. And then you write and you call them to first love. Let what we're writing cheer them up and bring them up and tell them you've left your first love, you've left your first consecration, you've left your first faith, you've left your first commitment, and come back unto the Lord. Write and call them back to the first love, and write and inspire faithfulness. In verse 10, fear none of those things which thou shalt suffer. Behold, the devil shall cast some of you into prison, that ye may be tried, and ye shall have tribulation, trial, trouble, 10 days, only 10 days. Be thou faithful unto death, and I will give thee a crown of life. John, write that to them and inspire them to be faithful. Number 4, write and warn the compromisers. Write and warn the compromisers. We're looking at verse 12. And to the angel of the church in Pergamos write. That's the commandment, that's the mandate, right? This thing says he that has the sharp sword out of it with two edges. I know thy works and where thou dwellest, even where Satan's seat is, and that thou holdest fast my name, and hast not denied my faith, even in those days wherein Antipas was my faithful martyr, who was slain among you where Satan dwelleth. But I have a few things against thee, because thou hast there them that hold the doctrine of Balaam, and who taught Balak to cast his stumbling block before the children of Israel, to eat things sacrificed to idols, and to commit fornication. Verse 16, repent or else. Repent or else. Your right to warn compromisers. You see, those of us who are in the writing business, those of us who are in the printing business, we don't just write something. You write in a definite way, and you write with a purpose in mind. You know that Christ is coming, and you are writing, you're giving them the message so that they will come to know the Lord, and through you, backsliders will come back. And compromisers will stand right, and they will do the will of God in Jesus' name. Number 5, write and expose the seducers. Write and expose the seducers. I'm reading from verse 17. I'm reading from this from verse 17 now. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. Verse 18, and unto the angel of the church in Thyatira, write. That's the command, that's the imperative, and that's the mandate, right? These things says the Son of God, who has eyes like unto a flame of fire, and his feet are fine brass. I know thy works, and thy charity, and thy faith, and thy service, and thy faith, and thy patience, and thy works, and the last of them more than the first. No, notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest, you have allowed and you have permitted that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants to commit fornication and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. And then he goes on to say in verse 23, and I will kill her children or death, and all the churches shall know that I am he which searches and the reins and hearts, and I will give unto every one of you according to your works. Write and expose the seducers, the Jezebels that will be kind of deceiving other people. Look at chapter 3. I'm looking at this now. The imperative and the commandment he has given us. Chapter 3, verse 1. And unto the angel of the church in Sardis write, this thing says he that has 7 spirits of God and the 7 stars. I know thy works, that thou hast a name, that thou livest and art dead. John, write to them. What am I writing to them? Tell them, be watchful and strengthen the things which remain that are ready to die. For I have not found thy work perfect before God. Remember therefore how thou hast received and heard, and hold fast and repent. You see, he was writing now to arouse watchfulness. Right to arouse watchfulness and stir up the hearts of the people. Let the people know where they are careless, where they are not following the Lord, and where things are dead and they are thinking they are still alive. Right and arouse watchfulness. Look at verse 7, chapter 3, verse 7. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia, write. You see, the Lord was telling him every time, you're right, you're right, you're right, you're right. And I pray that you'll get into the ministry. I said somebody there will get into the ministry. And to the angel of the church in Philadelphia, write. This thing says, he that is holy, he that is true, and he that has the key of David, he that openeth and no man shutteth and no man openeth, I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. No man can shut it. No man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and even with that little strength, thou hast kept my word and hast not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, which say they are Jews and are not, but do lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before your feet. I thought you'd say amen. And to know that I have loved thee. And then he says in verse 11, behold, I come quickly. Hold fast that fast which thou hast, that no man take your crown. Look up at me here. You have a crown to wear. Amen. Nobody will take that crown. Amen. The opportunities the Lord has given, the calling he has given you, you're going to fulfill it in Jesus' name. Write and encourage the obedient. That's what he was to do here. Write and encourage the obedient. I'm looking at chapter 3, verse 14. Chapter 3, verse 14. And unto the angel of the church of the Laodiceans, write. This thing says the Amen, the faithful and the true witness, the beginning of the creation of God. I know thy works, that thou art neither cold nor hot. I would thou wert cold or hot. So then, because thou art lukewarm and neither cold nor hot, I'll spew thee out of my mouth. And then he goes on to say in verse 19, as many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous therefore and repent. Write and stir up the lukewarm. Write and stir up the lukewarm. And as you do that, you're fulfilling your ministry. You write and send. You write and call them to the first love. You write and inspire faithfulness. You write and warn the compromisers. You write and expose the seducers. You write and you arouse watchfulness. You write and you encourage obedience. You write and you stir up the lukewarm. We're looking at Revelation chapter 21. Revelation chapter 21. As we look at this, Revelation chapter 21, we're still looking at the commandment that Jesus gave John, and that is giving all right. We're looking at chapter 21, verse 5. He that sat on the throne said, behold, I make all things new. I thought our people say amen. For these words are true and faithful. He said unto me, write. He said unto me, write. He says unto you, write. Verse 6. And he said unto me, it is done. Amen. Your problems are solved. Amen. It is done. Amen. The door is open. Amen. It is done. Amen. The promises are fulfilled. Amen. It is done. Amen. You are an overcomer. Amen. He said unto me, it is done. I am Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. I will give unto him that is athirst the fountain of the water of life freely. He that overcometh, somebody there. He that overcometh, somebody there. He that overcometh shall inherit, shall inherit, shall inherit all things. And I will be his God, and he shall be my son. Write and reveal the promise for overcomers. Write and reveal the promise for overcomers. The Lord has given us, number one, he has shown us his glorified form. He has shown us his glorious personality. He has shown us his governing rule. And now he gives us the mandate. And he says, you go out, you work for him, you serve him, he will never leave you. He'll never forsake you. And from this day, you come to new strength in Jesus' name. And that door that is open, you'll go through that door. And all the door that is shut, calamity is gone. Evil things are gone. Because you have your faith, you have your confidence in the God Almighty and in the one that says, I was dead, I'm alive, and I'm alive forevermore. And it's alive for you. I said it's alive for you. What are you there? Why don't you stand up and say, Lord, I thank you for the revelation of Jesus Christ, the glorified Christ, the glorified Christ, the glorified Christ. And understand, he's on your side, he's on your side. He is for you, and you are for him. And then, if you have not given your life to the Lord Jesus Christ, today is the day to say, Lord, I didn't know that Christ is so exalted, that Christ is so great, and Christ is so mighty, is the mighty glorified Christ. Surrender your life to him and things will become totally, totally, completely different. You'll never be the same again. And let his majesty work in your life. Is the glorious Son of Man, is the glorious Son of God, is the mighty one, and he will solve all the problems. All the problems you are thinking about, they are small, small things. It'll crush the head of the enemy out of your life in Jesus' name. Talk to the Lord, talk to the Lord, talk to the Lord. He is Savior, he is Redeemer, is the mighty one, is the glorious one, is the one that can never fail. His power can never fail, his promises can never fail. Why don't you call upon him now? Say, Lord, I thank you for the majesty of the glorified Christ. The majesty of the glorified Christ. He'll thresh the enemy. He will overcome the enemy. He'll overpower the enemy. Tell the Lord, and say, Lord, I belong to you. I belong to you, and your promises are yes and amen in my life. And the mystery of the glorious Christ, the mystery of the glorious Christ is holding those seven stars in his hand. Holding the seven stars in his hand. Holding the seven stars in his hand. And if you are one of those stars, it's holding you. It's holding you. Holding you. His sovereignty, his faithfulness, his power, his promise security. Come under the protection of the Lord, under the power of the Lord. And he says, fear not, he can crush every enemy. He can destroy every enemy. He can move every mountain. And he says, fear not. He says, I am. I am. The one that cannot fail, there I am. In the power of God, there I am. There I am that liveth forevermore. And he has the key. The keys of hell and death. No, you cannot die before your time. Those enemies do not have the final say in your life. Christ has the final say. Your Redeemer has the final say. A dream does not have the final say. A demon does not have the final say. Persecutors do not have the final say. Those who are hiding behind a draw somewhere thinking they can do something against your life, they don't have the final say. Christ, our Lord. Christ, our King. Christ, our Redeemer. He has the final say. He has the key. He has the key. And I give you the mandate. Your duty. Your responsibility. Says right, right, and send. Proclaim the message. Send forth the message. Rise and call them to the first love. Write and inspire faithfulness in other people. Write and warn them against corruption and compromise. Write and inspire faithfulness. Write and expose the false preachers, the false prophets, the seducers. Write and arouse watchfulness, that the people of God will arise and they'll watch so they can be ready. Write and encourage the obedient. Write and stop the lukewarm. Write and reveal the promise for overcomers. In Jesus' name we pray. Believers, I said, in Jesus' name we pray. Thank God today I am an overcomer. Thank God today an open door is before me. Thank God today the door to calamity is closed. The door to sickness is closed. And the door to enemies near closed. Thank God today I am an overcomer. I feel strong. I feel strong. Somebody there, I feel strong. And the Lord strengthen your backbone in Jesus' name. Raise up that hand there. Watch if you're under a fan. Don't raise the hand too far under a fan. Are you there? Do you know that tonight is a turning point in your life? Do you know that tonight joy has come? Every blessing that is locked up, the door is open, it will flow to you. And as you totally surrender your life to Christ, failure canceled, defeat canceled, sicknesses canceled. Are you ready? What are you? This is for you. Father, in Jesus' name, we bless your name for revealing Christ unto us. It's a glorified Christ. It's the exalted Christ. It's the mighty Christ. It's the overcoming Christ. It's the conquering Christ. It's the reigning Christ. And I pray, Lord, tonight you reign in every life in Jesus' name. All those tears that have come, all the suffering that have come, and all the sorrow that has come, oh Lord, I pray in your power, in your majesty, in your glory, in your goodness, wipe the tears away in Jesus' name. And I pray that every sickness in the midst of your people, Lord, you have the final say. Sickness does not have a final say. Demons do not have a final say. Oppressors do not have a final say. You have the key of destiny in your hand. And Lord, I pray, open the door of opportunities for your people in Jesus' name. And Lord, I pray, all the calamity and all the curse and all the yoke and all every evil sin, close the door in Jesus' name. I pray that your people will be conquerors. Your people will be overcomers. And as they go out of the Bible study tonight, new strength, new power, new energy, new opportunity, new open door, and new courage in Jesus' name. Enemies will see them and hide. Demons will see them and run. And calamities will see them and be diverted to another way. As they march out, oh Lord, I pray, this will be a mighty army. This will be an unconquerable army. And every one of us, brother, sister, boy, girl, every child, every man, every father, every mother, everyone that names the name of Christ here today, will take our place by the side of Jesus Christ. Make your people real overcomers. And Lord, the things that defeated us before, tonight we're now overcomers and conquerors in Jesus' name. do something special, something definite, something unique, that everyone will say, I got that thing, I got that miracle, I got that healing, I got that job, I got that opportunity, right there at the Bible study tonight. Confirm it, O Lord. Confirm it, O Lord. Confirm it, O Lord. Thank you, because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray.